you get these rings. And because they vary, you can match patterns like fingerprints in time. It's important for these reasons out in the climate system, or if it's the last ring on a panel on which one of the great Dutch masters painted something, and that last ring happens to be after the Dutch master died, then you have to speak to a very disappointed painting owner, right? I've had to do that. My name is Malcolm Hughes. I'm a Regents Professor of Dendrochronology, which is telling time using trees, here in the Laboratory of Tree Research at the University of Arizona in sunny Tucson.
My name is Japanese. Kiyomi is a Japanese name. Marino is also a Japanese name. I was named by my oba-chan, my grandmother. And one way that you can spell that name, the meaning of that name, is actually tree reader. So I guess I was meant to work at the tree ring lab. My oba-chan knew that.
Kiyomi Marino and I are trying to get into the mechanisms on the plant side. The plants are getting into my nose at the moment, actually. Our main project starts on Mount Bigelow. Can I do this? But it starts behind us, which is almost as tall as Mount Lemmon, but 40 minutes closer.
Abby is gonna take a bunch of samples from these trees that we've been tracking for a couple years now. This is the second year that we're tracking this group of trees. But we have been working at this site for about 5 years, starting in 2014. We go up to the mountain on a weekly basis, and we've selected a set of trees, all of them ponderosa pine.
I think we'll start with tree 5 today.
We follow these trees throughout the course of the growing season. So each week we take a micro core. We're basically tracking their growth, the formation of a tree ring, almost on a cell by cell basis.
Something that's very special to southern Arizona is what happens after a really dry April, May, June, when you know that you don't usually have to worry too much about washing your windscreen until usually July the 4th, when the monsoon comes along and puts out the fireworks on A Mountain. Everything slows right down when there's no water. But in fact, a few days before it comes, when the air is getting a bit more humid, the growth of the wood is already responding.
I mean, we have the system now where we can stockpile those. Yeah.
So that provides us with numbers that we can put into our models to then run the models back to make sure that we can explain what has already happened, and then run them forward a few years to see what various possible changes in our climate might affect tree growth.
No, that's good.
I think people that live and work in the forests and work with wood have known for thousands of years that tree stem was putting on an extra layer of growth each year. It took a feisty Yankee, Andrew Ellicott Douglas, to be brought down to the southwest to find telescope sites in clear, dry air, and ended up recommending Mars Hill in Flagstaff. This was in the late 1880s. 1906, the U of A has an opening, so he gets hired down here. And for him, it was all one field. This was part of astronomy.
From the very beginning, from when Douglas first started developing the science of dendrochronology, he was looking mostly at variability in tree ring width.
He didn't know much about plants. And if he'd known too much about plants, he would have thought it was impossible. So there are times when ignorance is really is bliss, even in science. So you'll try things that shouldn't work. And if they do, then you're off to the races.
Did you embed them anyhow then? I came into science a little bit later on. I actually didn't know, so I did my undergraduate here at the University of Arizona. I didn't know that the tree ring lab existed during my whole undergrad. And I blame that on the fact that it was in the football stadium, but not really. The strength of the tree rings is that they give us a much more complete picture of the variability of climate conditions on like centennial and sometimes millennial timescales, which is important to know. It puts the current conditions into context.
I was involved in one of the first papers using tree rings and other records to show how unusual the climate of the last three decades has been. And from some of the political and vested interests responses to that, there's clearly a problem of fessing up to the problem that we have. But then when I was a small boy, we had rationing of food because at the end of World War II, millions of people were being killed, and yet here we are. Look at the things that have changed in our society in the last 20 years about tobacco, about people's private lives, and so on. They were not thinkable in the 70s or 80s. So it's not a reason to be complacent or Pollyannish, but it's to say, what can we do? We need to get our act together and identify solutions. And I think there are quite a few. The main reason we do it is to find out how things work. You know, I mean, that's the driving impulse.
I like it.
Is to get under the hood of the natural system and find that relay or that fan belt that's gone, and figure out which is the right one to put back in. How does it actually work? That's the motivation that keeps us doing sometimes repetitive and crazy looking things for years in order to find something out. I'm half retired, I'm on a phased retirement, which was designed to make me start to think about, you know, a different period of life. I feel very, very fortunate. I came from a working class background. I'm a first generation college person. You know, even John Lennon had a song about it. You know, a working class hero is something to be.
I love being in the forest. I love having the excuse to take a close look at the forest. It forces you to sort of stop and look around and, you know, take into account your surroundings. And that is just, that's super invigorating. And it's especially great to go up in the mountains when it's like 115 down in Tucson.